Hi, everybody. My name is Michael Millerman, and this is an introduction to Leo Strauss. I have some notes prepared that I'd like to share with you. But before I do, I'd like to give you just a few words of background on how Strauss came to light for me. Each of you has your own story about why you've come to think Leo Strauss might be somebody worth studying. Maybe you know about the neoconservatives and this reputation that Strauss has as the godfather of the neoconservatives. Maybe you've heard something about persecution in the art of writing, or the idea that writers have to write between the lines, keeping their teaching hidden so that they don't pay a price when the censors come for their neck. Well, in my case, I was an undergraduate student in philosophy at the University of Winnipeg, and my first philosophy class was just absolutely enthralling to me. We began with Plato's Republic, the Confessions of St. Augustine, and all the way later to Nietzsche's Beyond Good and Evil, passing as well through Hegel, Descartes, and some other thinkers. And this class was just amazing to me. I was really under a spell and something like entranced. I just absolutely loved it. I connected with it so deeply. But the classes that I had later as an undergraduate, they didn't have that same effect on me. So after some time, I wanted to find out what was it about that class that really set it apart from everything else. And out of being open to that question, I discovered at some point a commonality among the translators of the texts that we'd been assigned. So for example, I said that we read Plato's Republic. We read a translation by Alan Bloom. We read The Prince by Machiavelli. It was a translation by someone named Harvey Mansfield. And gradually, I learned, just through reading as you do, that Bloom and Mansfield and some other figures like Thomas Pengel, for example, and later Seth Benardetti, later in my order of discovery, that they were all students of a single teacher, of Leo Strauss, and that they belonged to the school we might call Straussians, somehow super influenced by Strauss's insight and methods as a reader of specifically texts in the history of political philosophy, like, again, Plato, Aristotle, Hobbes, Locke, Machiavelli, Rousseau, Nietzsche. These students saw Strauss as being indispensable in understanding those old texts in a way that had become impossible to do because of traditions of interpretation and modern prejudices that had made us think we can't learn anything from the old books. We can only read them as a product of their own time. So I discovered Strauss by piecing together what it was that made my first philosophy professor so amazing. It happened to have been the influence of Leo Strauss on his pedagogy, on his teaching, on the books that he assigned, on his understanding of the importance of translations and their needing to be literal, all things that we're going to get into over the course of our discussions together, both in the recorded sessions and I hope in the seminars as well. So once I had discovered that Strauss is the common thread, I threw myself into the study of his texts as much as I could at this time as an undergraduate without any institutional support. I didn't have Straussians around me or other students who had been raised in that teaching. It was just this discovery and everything that Strauss had to offer. And what gradually came to light is that we can't think about what it means to be a citizen or a person in the modern West without understanding all of the philosophical transformations that have happened to bring us to where we are. That somehow the transformation that brought us into the modern West intellectually can't be understood without understanding what it was a reaction against. Not in terms of the economic and social forces, but specifically in terms of the teaching of the political philosophers about the nature of man, the good life, and the cosmos, really, or the whole to which we may or may not belong, depending on how you see these things. So Strauss brought to light these deep questions about the human being, the nature of our existence, the study of old books, the meaning of the gods for political life, or of God for political life, of revelation, and also of the problem of the philosopher in his relationship to the things that are believed by the political community. This is a crucial theme for Strauss, again, as we'll see when we go forward. So ever since I made the discovery that Strauss and his students are the best of teachers, I've done everything I could do to learn from Strauss himself as a teacher and from the texts that he directs us to. Because at the end of the day, what I want to impress upon you is that Strauss is more than anything, even though in his own right, he's a profound thinker and he is a indispensable thinker for us. Above all, in a sense, he's a guide to the texts themselves. And his guidance there is more than just a matter of, you know, Strauss says to read the Republic, so we go and read the Republic. Because we learn how to read the Republic when we see the way that Strauss himself read it. We learn how to read the medieval philosophers, medieval political philosophers, or legal scholars when we see the way, I mean, the best of them, when we see how Strauss read them. We understand the possibility and the promise of a genuine education, a liberal education. That means an education that liberates our mind from the heavy realm of opinion or of ignorance. We learn what that is, what it entails, and why it's amazing under Strauss's guidance. So I hope to just share with you over the course of these presentations and over the course of our time together in the seminars, what some of what Strauss has to offer in understanding politics, the human situation, the great texts, and the world that we find ourselves in today.